Next on the bench is a English grandfather clock, I should say English movement, inside of an American clock case that was made in Pennsylvania by a Michael Whitmire. As with most clocks that I get in, they don't work. It needs to be serviced. This one's got quite a bit of age to it. I'm assuming at least 180 years old. Maybe older. Another feature of this clock is that made it kind of interesting. Look at the size of these chain links. And the most interesting feature is there's only one chain for time and strike. It has a continuous loop. Here's the bottom of the seat board, and as you can see, there's just one pulley for the weight, so obviously it's just one big massive weight. This is a standard kind of English movement, maybe a little bit smaller than most that I work on. Oh, it's very tight. I can see a might need some bushing work here. Well, isn't that something? The time side is normally on the other side, so this should be fun to break into and work on it. Let's see if we can see some kind of maker's name on this. I don't see anything written anywhere. Wow. Okay, let's take off the dial. Okay, I just rotated it 45 degrees and it comes right off like we had planned. The minute hand comes off and the hour hand is being a little bit tougher to get off. As with all movements that I work on, I really don't know what I'm getting into, and that kind of gives you a fresh look at exactly what you'll be going through when you first come in contact with some of these clocks. We need to remove the dial. And as you can see, the dial has got a tapered pin holding it on right there. And you simply go around the front of it to see how the dial is connected to the movement. I just put the camera up on my light fixture, which I use as a camera mount as well. So you get a bird's eye view. You're looking straight down onto my table right now. Hopefully I remember. Can you... let me get you zoomed in here. You think that needs a bushing? Maybe? And it looks like nothing except the snail is holding on to this guy. I'm pretty sure the manufacturer would have wanted a little washer underneath here, but and that would stop the rack assembly from coming up and off. Okay, I'm back. I'm going to be taking off the front plate next. It doesn't look like anything is coming through the front plate that won't let go when I simply lift it up. Shine up the brass a little bit. Variable speed on my lathe since I have a 110 volt DC motor, and I put a router speed control on there from Harbor Freight, and then I put a full wave bridge rectifier to change the AC coming out of the Harbor Freight into pulsating DC, and it gives a really nice speed controller for very little money. is a place called surpluscenter.com that you can buy a lot of motors from. They sometimes have really good deals on motors. This is the Jacob's chuck that I was talking about. It's this one I unscrewed from a regular hand drill. And it has a thread in the back, a Jacob's chuck, I forget which number it is. And I bought an adapter from TAG that allows me to take this headstock thread, which is in here, and it turns it into a Jacob's chuck. I use this an awful lot. And it makes the chuck very small, which is nice. Plus, it's easy to open and close without a key. And you see the jaws, they're actually grabbing the arbor. And the pinion in the back is actually free-floating. It's not being touched by the jaws. The jaws only clamp in the front. So that's why I like using the Jacobs a lot. It gives me that extra bit of versatility. Next, we're going to do the escape wheel. Now you can see it a little bit better. Really dirty. Stay clear of these little shark's teeth here, especially with the abrasive pad. It'll grab it out of your fingers very quickly. So make sure that your fingers are not tied up inside of it. Yeah, this clock's got so much to do on it. I gotta repair that click, and the only way, because it's not really doing its job. Although it's behaving itself now, but it does have an awful lot of play in it. See the pivot part? See it moving around right there? That's where it pivots. What we're going to be doing next is replacing all of these pins that are halfway worn out. I'm afraid they're going to snap. What I did so far before I started taping was I wanted to try a couple myself just to make sure I didn't make two. Center punch. Zoom in for you. So you can almost see what I'm doing. That one popped the pin out completely. First one that did that. A couple of seconds on the lathe and we're back. Next on our plate is to fix up this stop pin right here. Not only is the stop pin bent over because of another problem in the clock, but it's also loose. So let's go ahead and replace this with a new stop pin. And now we're going to mushroom over the end a little bit, not too much. I'm supporting the pin on the block so the brass gear is not going through any kind of trauma. In case you did not know about fan governors and what the reason that they exist, here's another movement with a working fan governor. You can see it's just a piece of brass hooked on with a little strip of brass on each side, and it's allowed to turn on that particular arbor with just a little bit of resistance. It can slip. See that? And the reason that they put it on there is twofold. One is that when it spins, the faster it spins, the more air it moves and the slower it wants to go. It acts like a brake. So this way it doesn't go gong, 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 gong. It actually goes bong, 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 the way it should, in a pleasing kind of a way. The second thing is the reason that it slips. It should slip easy enough that when the train comes to a complete stop suddenly, that even though this fan is still moving at a big speed, that it's allowed to slip a little bit until it can stop without shooting all of that stress down into these wheels and causing the wheels and pins to break. Now this type of bushing work that I'm about to do can be done on a bushing machine like this, which is kind of pricey, or you can do it by hand, but you need to use a preacher in order to indicate all the holes. Well, I'm going to use it anyway, because in case the bushing goes in the wrong place, slightly off, the preacher is going to tell me that, and I'll be able to pop out the bushing, put in a blind bushing that doesn't have a hole in it, and then use the preacher to put a divot and the new blind bushing. But Jeff finished bushing all of the areas on the particular plates, and now is the time to start putting things back together. When you take the wheels and such and put them inside here, most of the adjustments can be done outside of the plates, except for the position of this of the great wheel on the strike side. Here we have the English moving up on the test stand, and as you can see, the minute hand and the little quartz clock that I have in the back there, the two coincide after running the entire night. They seem to be running good. I got the little microphone clipped on in the back there. We'll show that to you in a second. And whenever it goes into warning, I'm going to throw the timeout now. See the way it just went into warning? Oh, that was 1 o'clock. Warning. 2 o'clock, and so on. We're pretty much done with this video now. I need to bring this back to the customer site, and they can get to enjoy their clock again. This is Al Takatsch from Jefferson ClockWorks. Thank you very much for watching.